So hi, hello and welcome again. Microbe Hunter here. My name is Oliver and today I'm going to show you how you can put this piece of old wood under the microscope. It's a simple preparation technique and I'm quite sure that we're able to find at least a few interesting microorganisms. A little bit of some background information first. This piece of wood that you see in here was completely dried up. I found it several days ago in the forest, and usually when samples are dry, you're not able to see a lot of movement and a lot of life under the microscope, because of course anything that was alive before either has died because of the dryness, or some microorganisms are able to form cysts that are able to withstand the dryness, and then you have to add a little bit of water and you have to wait a couple of days for them to kind of come back to life, so to say, to regenerate and to reproduce. And that's basically where we are right now. So this piece of wood has been in here now in this water for several days now. When you put specimens into water like this, make sure that you do not submerge them completely, right? Because microorganisms do need oxygen as well. And if you cover it completely with water, then of course you're going to cut off the oxygen supply. So I just put a little bit of water here on the bottom, and then by capillary action, the water was soaked up into the wood, and now everything is quite ready to be observed. So I have to get it out first. So let's do that. So here we go. And now how are we gonna continue with that? My recommendation is the following. I've made myself a little stand here. This is that you take, it's fine now, we can actually touch it like this. You take some object and you scratch off carefully a little bit from the surface, and you basically collect whatever you've got here on the microscope slide. So let's put down a small drop of water first. And then it's actually quite easy. You just carefully take off a little bit of the sample here and just make sure that there is enough solid material present as well. And then later on, we're going to remove some of the solid material again, because otherwise the cover glass is not able to be completely flat. Some lichens here as well, maybe. Look up. Yeah, I think this should kind of be enough. I just put it back again into the container. Yeah, and I'm now going to remove the slightly larger pieces here. Cover glass goes on top, and you see actually it's not, there's a lot of air in here because some of the particles are still too large. Yeah, here we go. So I'm just going to remove any excess liquid as well. I want to make sure that the cover glass is completely flat and does not float. And we're ready to observe. Yeah, well, I can confirm there is plenty of life present here. This here, for example, is a nematode worm. Somehow it must have survived the dryness. But there are many other interesting creatures also. Lots of single-celled organisms here. Protists, for example, you see that there's quite a bit of movement going on here. Yeah, over the last couple of days, those cells that did survive were able to reproduce now, and this is where we are. What is this one over here? This is a weird thing. Interesting. What could that be? Let's increase the magnification a bit. Well, I wonder. Of course, many of you already know what this is here. Yeah, yeah. This is of course a water bear, a moss piglet. Yeah. So there are lots of them in here because a few days ago when I put it also under the microscope, I also immediately found one. Yeah. So you see that. Plenty of interesting things here. And if you know where to look for microorganisms and microanimals, then it's actually not even that difficult. One of the disadvantages concerning those tardigrades, those water bears, is that they like to cling to objects, like for example to this debris over here. So sometimes they're covered up a little bit. That's basically what I want to share with you. Is you don't need to have a pond somewhere close by. Take an old piece of wood with some lichens growing on it, some fungi growing on it, and add a little bit of water and allow the living things to regenerate for a couple of days, and then put it directly under the microscope. And honestly, this is indeed the specimen that I just prepared. So it's not like this that I had to make 10 different slides and then I finally found the tardigrade. Really, this is the first right the first try that I have over here, right? So let's go up still in any case. I know some of you are probably already feeling fed up by those tardigrades because I keep returning to those over and over and over again. I already made so many videos about those. But still, I mean, I still like them. I've seen them so many times already. And I know that some, especially beginners, for them, finding the first tardigrade in the sample is a little bit almost like a, how do you call it, a rite of passion. Yeah, as it's called, yeah, because it's you do have to search a little bit, and if you don't find them right away, then you I would say change the specimen sample. Yeah, try to look at a different specimen because sometimes if they're present, then they're present even in quite quite high numbers. Huh? So yeah, so that's basically the tardigrade, right? Not surprisingly to be found there, but still a nice find, and they are able to withstand dryness because they're able to form basically cysts that are able to withstand lack of water as well. Yeah? As a matter of fact, I mean, they did send them also into space. You probably already heard about that as well. So they've been doing quite a lot of experiments with them as well. So, but let's maybe we're able to find a few other interesting ones. Yeah. So let's have a look here. Here at the top, you see also a protozoan. Yeah. So I switched on the arrow right now so I can show it to you. Yeah. Over here. And those are oval structures that you see over here. Let me get them into focus. These look very, very much like the spores of a fungus. Okay. So fungal spores look like this. Look, this one already started to divide here a little bit. And in the background, those tiny little objects moving in the background, these are bacteria. So it kind of also gives you a nice comparison, a size comparison between single-celled protozoans up here, okay? The spores of fungi and or the prokaryotes, the bacteria, which you see in the background over here. So you see there is lots of decomposition going on here, and those protozoans, those protists here, ciliates, flagellates, amoeba and so on, they feed on those bacteria here in the background. Yeah, I found another interesting place here. Look on the bottom here, that is an air bubble, right? And usually microorganisms, they like to gather around air bubbles because, of course, many of them do need a lot of oxygen. I'm saying many because not all of them, yeah? But those ciliates and flagellates, mostly ciliates here that you see, are indeed, because of their rapid movement, they have a high oxygen consumption, right? And for this reason, you often find them gather around air bubbles, yeah? And you see all of those dark things around here, yeah? I don't know, decomposing material, that's plenty of food for them as well, right? Plus a lot of bacteria, of course, as I just mentioned, yeah? Yeah, I just found something interesting that I would like to share with you. We're now again in phase contrast, and we're now able to see a few things that we could not see quite as well before. But if you look carefully, there are several bacteria moving around, rod-shaped bacteria, elongated bacteria, and they seem to be very bright on one side, right? They have this white dot. Yeah, if you look, try to follow the arrow along here, maybe this one over here, right? But there's several of those. Right? And those bacteria essentially seem to be forming so-called endospores. So the bright round structure inside the cell seems to be this type of endospore. And endospores are essentially ways how those bacteria are able to withstand dryness. So when the conditions turn bad, some bacteria are able to form these endospores. And it could be that essentially these bacteria belong to the genus Bacillus, because bacilli are essentially rod-shaped bacteria which are able to form endospores. Of course, one would have to do a proper genetic test, DNA test, to confirm that. If you just use classical microbiology, then that's probably the conclusion that you're going to derive. There are quite a few of those. Look, moving around, rod-shaped bacteria with these bright structures inside the cell. Quite nice to see. So I just want to show you two other things here. Those funny structures up here, these are so-called conidia. Conidia are also the spores of a fungus. So not only those oval round ones over here, but also these here. And also these brown oval structures here seem to be spores of a fungus. But I want to show you this one here in particular. Look, it not only looks green, it's a sign that it contains chlorophyll and it's doing photosynthesis, but specifically look at all those tiny bacteria that have have really clustered and gathered around it. This is the reason why they're doing that is because the cell here is doing photosynthesis and is producing oxygen. And the bacteria around it, they really need the oxygen. They like the oxygen. That's why they've gathered around it here. You find this quite often that photosynthetic algae, for example, or other photosynthetic organisms, diatoms and so on, when they produce oxygen, that bacteria gather and cluster around it. Something that you can observe quite frequently. And also shows you a little bit as an indirect way of whether this structure is still alive or not, right? And it is, because evidently it's producing oxygen.
Yeah, I think this one here is also quite a nice one. Look at the stream of water that it generates. Yeah, so the bacteria in the background are now also carried along by the water stream. So there are tiny little hair on the surface here called cilia that are beating, and they're generating this water stream here, and that's how it's feeding. It's always sucking in particles, debris, bacteria, and it's feeding on them. And then when it's got enough food and when it's grown in size, then it's also going to start to divide, of course. And you can look at all of those cell organelles in there. I wonder if these are all food vacuoles or not. I don't know. Yeah, but in any case, you can see those beautiful, beautiful is probably not the right word here, but those tiny little fast beating here. And what I'm going to do now is I'm going to just look at the whole thing now in phase contrast. Maybe we're able to see a few other structural details. Yeah, this here is now in phase contrast. The cilia are beating so quickly that you actually still do not see them. But at least the bacteria in the background are now a little bit better visible, because they appear a little bit darker on a bright background. I'm just going to say the following. Get yourself a microscope if you don't already have one and start observing. And I hope that these little videos here basically also inspire you to pick up the hobby as microscopy if you have not already done so. Yeah, I think I'm just going to leave it at that. I wish you all the best. Happy microbe hunting as always, and see you in the next video. Bye-bye.